Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Gambler's Denver Draw by Robert J. Randisi, narrated by Jack Garrett. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Robert J. Randisi. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. On the run from the assassins who murdered his family, Ty Butler found a new way to survive with a few good hands, a loaded gun, and a little luck. But since he started earning a serious rep at the poker table, lying low and keeping out of his hunter's gun sights is getting harder and harder to do. And now, Denver Draw.
Chapter 1. Leadville, Colorado. Tyrone Butler? Frank Rode asked. That's right. Say, weren't you involved in that whole Dodge City mess a while back? He asked. What mess? Billy Brookins asked. You know, that shootout in the plaza thing, Chase said. It was in the newspapers. I remember that, Pete Brand said. Ty Butler looked at the other four players at the table. None of the four were particularly good poker players, and this was a good reason why. None of them were paying attention to the hand. Coming out, Butler, the dealer, said. He ignored their questions and their conversation. Jack, no help. Three, too bad. Pair of kings on the table. A queen for the dealer. Brookins bet his kings, tossing $10 into the pot. Rode called. Butler called. Brand frowned at the three on the table with his 8 and 10, all unsuited, but he called. He always called, no matter what he had. It worked in his favor once in a while, but mostly he just tossed good money after bad. Leadville had been easy pickings for Butler, who was planning to leave the next morning. He'd built up a nice poke. Plus, he'd rested up enough after the whole Dodge City fiasco that the others were talking about. Standing side by side in the streets of Dodge with Bat and Jim Masterson, not to mention Neil Brown, had been invigorating. But everything leading up to it had been tiring. Yet he now felt renewed and ready to travel again. Leadville had been a good place to recuperate, both mentally and physically.
That dust up in Dodge was nothing compared to what happened in Tombstone right after that, Rode said. I heard Masterson ran out on the Earps and left them and Doc Holliday to do the dirty work, Brand said.
I heard a lot of things about Bat Masterson, Brookins said, but never that he was a coward.
First time for everything, Rode said.
Butler held his tongue and dealt out the fifth and final card. A queen joined his other queen on the table. He had one in the hole. He felt he had the winning hand, but that was nothing new. Brookins had kings on the table, but Butler had a read on the man. That was all he had. It was more likely that Brand had lucked into three threes by staying in. It was going to cost him money. Rode was out of it, and demonstrated so by folding. Brookins bet his kings, Butler raised, and Brand foolishly re-raised. With two raisers, Brookins knew his kings were no food and went out.
I raise again, Butler said. The kid had three threes. He could see it on his face. 9 times out of 10, that was a winning hand.
This was 10, but the kid wouldn't consider that.
I'm putting the rest of my money in against you, Mr. Butler, he said, pushing his cash into the center of the table.
It wasn't much, because he had been losing all night, but it was all he had. Butler covered the bet.
I got three trays, Mr. Butler, Brand said. Can you beat that?
Butler turned over his third queen.
What's wrong with you, boy?
Rode, the oldest player at the table, asked.
Ain't you been watching this man play all night?
Pete Brand looked as if he was going to cry. Finally, he just pushed his chair back, got up, and went to the bar. Butler collected his chips. Rode gathered the cards to deal.
The kid was probably wrong about Bat Masterson being a coward, too,
Brookins said. He was, Butler said. Brookins and Rode looked at him. Bat left Tombstone to go to Dodge to keep his brothers alive, Butler said. That's why he wasn't at the OK Corral. And any man who says different is going to have to deal with me.
Rode shuffled the cards and kept quiet. Brookins opened his mouth to speak, then thought better of it.
Way I heard it, a voice from the bar called out. Masterson didn't even go to Dodge. He just plumb lit out from Tombstone and kept going until he reached Trinidad, and he's a hiding out there.
Butler didn't know the voice. He turned to see who the speaker was. The man was in his early 30s, was holding a mug of beer and smirking for the benefit of his friends standing at the bar with him, of which there were three.
That's Troy Smithson, Butler, Frank Rhodes said to him. Don't let him goad you into a gunfight. He's fast.
I know about Smithson, Frank, Butler said. I've been here long enough for that.
Then you know to ignore him, Billy Brookins said. Come on, gentlemen, let's play cards.
But Troy Smithson was not easily ignored. During the time Butler had been in Leadville, close to a month, Smithson had goaded or called out three men and killed them all in a fair fight. The town laws, such as it was, turned its head because Smithson worked for one of the largest mine owners in Colorado. He wasn't a miner. He was more of a bodyguard or enforcer. Apparently, now that he had heard Butler's word about Bat Masterson, he decided that Ty Butler would be his next victim. Chapter 2. Smithson kept talking about Bat Masterson, questioning not only his courage, but his manhood as well. Butler lost the next hand because he couldn't concentrate. If he didn't shut this idiot up, he'd have to stop playing.
Deal me out this hand, Butler said. Just this hand? Rhode asked.
One hand. Butler nodded. He stood up, turned, and walked to the bar, where Smithson was holding court with his friends. The man had a decided height and weight advantage on Butler, but the gambler did not intend to fight with him.
Can I help you? Smithson asked.
I can only assume that you're trying to annoy me with all this talk about Bat Masterson.
He a friend of yours?
More of an acquaintance, Butler said. I'm actually friends with Jim Masterson.
Jim? Smithson laughed. He got run out of Dodge, didn't he? With his tail between his legs?
Well, Butler said, whatever you think of the Mastersons, that's not why I'm here.
Why are you here? Smithson asked. In my face, where you don't belong.
I'm playing in a poker game over there, Butler said, and you're interfering with my concentration.
That penny ante game?
The stakes were higher than that, but that wasn't the point.
Yes, that game, Butler said.
I'll give you 2 bits to go away. Butler took the 25 cents out of his pocket.
2 bits? One of Smithson's friends asked, laughing. That's all you're worth, Troy?
Another one asked. I'm only offering 2 bits, Butler said, clarifying the point, because I don't have a plugged nickel on me. The room took notice of what was going on at the bar, and suddenly it got very quiet.
Jesus, Troy, friend number one said. He's saying you ain't even worth a plug nickel. That ain't what he's saying, you idiot, friend number two said. He's saying Troy is worth a plug nickel. Both men started to laugh. Shut up, Smithson snapped. Both men did. That what you're saying, friend? Smithson demanded. I'm worth a plug nickel. Did I say a plug nickel? Butler asked. Maybe just a regular nickel. But whichever it is, I'm offering you a whole quarter. There was some laughter from the room, but when Smithson looked around, it stopped.
Mister, are you trying to make a fool out of me?
He demanded pugnaciously. You don't need my help for that, friend. Smithson frowned, still not sure what was going on. I'll tell you what, Butler said. How about I buy you and your friends beer, and you just shut your mouth?
Hey, that sounds good to me, Troy, friend number one said. Shut up, Pete, Smithson said, and then turned his attention back to Butler. Mister, you know who I am.
I've got a pretty good idea what you are, Butler said. Who you are doesn't really matter to me. Smithson puffed out his chest and said,
It better matter to you if you know what's good for you.
Troy, friend number two said, maybe we oughta.
Maybe you oughta just shut the hell up, Dusty,
Smithson suggested forcefully. His friend, Pete Brand, and Dusty Rich, knew when Troy Smithson was on the edge, so they decided to take his advice and shut up. They didn't want to become the targets for his anger. They'd leave that to the gambler, who obviously did not know who he was dealing with. What do you say, fella? Ty Butler asked. You want to take that free beer?
I don't want no beer from you, friend, Smithson said. I want you out in the street.
Now?
Right now.
Getting dark out there, Butler said, looking out the front window. You sure?
It's light enough for me to kill you.
Okay, then, Butler said. You go ahead. I'll be right out, soon as I make sure my money is safe. Smithson looked at the other two.
You guys stay here, he said. This won't take long.
With that, Troy Smithson stormed outside into the street to await Butler's arrival. Everyone in the room expected Butler to collect his money and follow the man out. Instead, all Butler did was turn around, return to his table, and reclaim his seat.
I thought he'd never leave, he said. Deal me in, boys.
Chapter 3. It took Smithson's friends a few minutes before they realized Butler was not going to go outside. They exchanged a glance and then walked over to the table.
Mister? Dusty asked.
Yes, Butler replied.
You do know that Troy is waiting for you outside, right?
I know that.
Ain't you gonna go out?
Not if I can help it.
But, Pete Brand said, he called you out.
Butler looked up at both of them. And you think that means I have to go out?
Well, yeah, Brand said.
Forget it, Butler said. I've got a hot hand going here, boys. I ain't about to walk away from this game.
But Troy's gonna be mad, Dusty said.
Let him get mad. What do I care?
Mister, he'll kill you, Brand said.
He's right, Butler, one of the other poker players said. Smithson's mean, and you're just making him meaner by leaving him standing out there. He'll come in here and shoot up the place,
another card player added.
Where's the sheriff when you need him? Butler asked.
You've been in Leadville long enough to know Sheriff Galloway ain't worth shit, Butler, the first player said.
You got him riled up. You're gonna have to deal with him.
Butler looked around the table. All of the players were staring at him and nodding, as well as some of the onlookers.
You fellas don't care one way or the other who gets killed, do you? He asked. Just so long as he doesn't come in here shooting and interrupt the game.
I care,
one of the players said. The others looked at him.
Hey, Butler's got most of my money, he complained. I want a chance to get it back.
Can't much blame you for that, Butler said. He looked around at Smithson's two friends. Go and tell your buddy I'll be out directly.
He's probably pretty mad as it is, Dusty said. He might shoot the first man comes out the door, Brand said.
Then you better make sure he knows it's you, Butler replied. Hadn't you?
Yeah, sure, Brand said. Okay.
The two men went to the batwing doors and then cautiously stepped outside. Sounds like you all want me to do this, Butler said. The men around the table nodded. Onlookers did just that. Butler sighed. You realize this means I'll have to kill him?
You could go out the back door, someone said. Leave town.
Butler sat back. The game had been ruined for him, and he had intended to leave Leadville the next day anyway. Going out the back door had some merit.
That'd be the coward's way out, another voice said. Go on out and kill him. He's a tin gun anyway, always looking to hire out and prove himself.
That's when it occurred to Butler that this might be something totally different.
You ain't got a price on your head, does you? Somebody asked.
Actually, he did, though not a lawfully placed one. Could Smithson have been trying to goad him into a fight in order to collect? Suddenly, going out the back door didn't seem like such a good idea.
I'm cashing out, he announced. Ain't coming back, even if you kill him?
A player asked.
No, Butler said. I'm done with the game, and done with Leadville. I'll be leaving in the morning.
If and you ain't dead tonight, somebody said.
He looked around but could not pick out the man who had spoken. Outside, Troy Smithson said to his two friends,
So, do you think he bought it?
He bought it, Dusty said. He'll be coming out thinking he's only got to face you.
Good.
You was real good in there, Troy, Brand said. I thought you was really losing your temper.
Smithson glared at Brand and said,
I was. I hate that gambler. Thinks he's so much better than us.
Well, he's gonna learn different, Dusty said.
Yeah, he is, Smithson said. He sure is. Check your guns, boys. We're about to make us some money.
They fanned out in front of the hotel, checked their loads, holstered their guns, and waited. In the end, Butler did decide to go out the back door, in spite of the jeers and barbs that were fired at him by the patrons of the saloon. It turned out to be an excellent idea. Chapter 4. Butler moved down alongside the saloon until he reached the street. Sure enough, standing out in front of the saloon were the three friends, fanned out and waiting for him. It had all been an act, designed to lure him outside, convinced that he would only be facing one man, Troy Smithson. He drew his gun, briefly considered taking two of them right then and there, leaving the third to be questioned. Try as he might, though, he couldn't convince himself to shoot them from hiding. He was not a bushwhacker, and holstered his weapon. He stepped out of the alley, up onto the boardwalk. It was a dark night, with a sliver of a moon and almost no stars. Leadville streets were not well lit. The three men had been outside long enough for their eyes to adjust, but they were waiting for him to step out of the lighted saloon. If he had done that, he probably would not have even noticed there were three men until it was too late. But from the shadows, it was he who would be able to see, and they who would be blind. "You boys put on a good act," he called out. All three men were startled, began glancing around to see where the voice had come from.
"That you, Butler?" Smithson said. "Come out where I can see you."
"You mean come out where you can all gun me down?" Butler said.
"I don't think so." "What are you talking about?" Smithson asked. "This is just between you and me."
"That a fact? Then suppose you tell your buddies to drop their guns in the street and walk away. Then I'll come out and face you. Just you and me." Smithson didn't answer right away. The other two looked at him, then at each other.
"They'll walk away," Smithson said. "That ought to be good enough."
"No," Butler said. "It's not." Finally, Smithson seemed to locate him, staring into the shadows. So Butler moved a few feet to his left.
"There!"
Smithson shouted, pointing with his left hand and drawing his gun with his right.
"He's there! Get him!"
All three men drew and began firing where Smithson was pointing. By that time, Butler had moved even further to the left and stepped into a doorway, putting him even deeper in shadow. The fact that the three men were firing also freed him to do the same without any guilt about firing from cover. He drew and shot Dusty through the chest. As the man fell onto his back in the street, the other two men trained their weapons on Butler's muzzle flash. But Butler was moving again. They fired. Glass began breaking. And now Butler was in the street with them. He fired a second time, taking Pete Brand in the hip. The impact spun him around, and Butler's next shot struck him in the back. Brand fell on his face. It was quiet. Butler and Smithson were standing in the street alone. Patrons from the saloon had crowded around the door and windows to watch.
"Holster it," Butler said, "or we can both start firing."
Smithson stared at him.
I'm empty."
"That's because you wasted a lot of lead breaking windows."
"You gonna kill me?"
Smithson asked.
"That's up to you." "What do you mean?"
"Who sent you?" Smithson looked confused, asked again,
"What do you mean?"
"Load your gun, Troy."
"But I..."
"Go ahead, load it," Butler said. "I'm not about to shoot an unarmed man." If Smithson had been smart, he would have dropped his gun in the street upon hearing Butler's declaration. But he wasn't smart. He ejected the spent shells from his gun, and then slowly began to reload from his gun belt. "Okay, now holster it." Smithson stood stock still, gun in hand, but pointed down toward the street. "Don't even think about it, Troy," Butler said. "Holster it." Grudgingly, Smithson did as he was told. "Now, I'm going to ask you again," Butler said. "Who sent you and your partners after me?"
"Nobody sent us," the other man said. "We heard there was paper out on you."
"Are you bounty hunters?"
"No."
"Then why come after me?"
There's a lot of money on your head.
Put there by who?
Hell, I don't know, Smithson said. How would I know? All I know is what the paper says.
Where's the paper now?
I don't know, he said. Dusty had it.
You don't know a hell of a lot, do you, Troy? Butler asked. Except that I was worth money to you dead.
Smithson shrugged and said,
Nothing personal, Butler.
Really? I take somebody trying to kill me very personal, Butler said. He holstered his own gun. Now's your chance, Troy.
Huh?
Go ahead, Butler said. Earn your money.
Smithson continued to look confused.
Come on, Troy, Butler said. Make a move. Either draw your gun or walk away.
Butler kept a wary eye on Smithson. By now, they were both able to see each other equally well. Butler was able to make out the expression on Smithson's face. Even as the man started to turn, as if to walk away, Butler knew he was going to try it. When Smithson went for his gun, turning back, hoping to catch Butler unaware, he was surprised to find Butler ready for him. The gambler drew and shot him in the chest twice. He figured the man deserved one bullet for his deceit and one for his stupidity.
Hold it!
Butler turned and saw Sheriff Galloway walking toward him with his gun out. Sheriff, you better holster that or use it.
What?
Galloway, a tall man in his 30s with a straggly goatee, stopped short.
Are you threatening me?
No threat, Butler said. I've just looked down the barrel of enough guns tonight.
What went on here?
Reluctantly, the lawman holstered his weapon.
I think you know. I think you watched and waited for it to be all over.
I need to know what went on here,
Galloway repeated lamely.
Ask them, Butler said, pointing to the men in the saloon, still peering out the windows and the door. They'll tell you. I'm going to bed.
Butler holstered his gun and started to walk away, then turned back.
Oh, and I'll be gone by morning, and not a minute too soon to suit me.
Chapter 5. Trinidad, Colorado. Bat Masterson stepped out of his office and looked up and down the street. When he had first come to Trinidad some months ago, he hadn't intended to stay long. He certainly hadn't intended to become town marshal. The incident he privately referred to as the debacle in Dodge City had left him with a bad taste in his mouth, not to mention the fact that leaving Tombstone to go to Dodge to help his brother Jim meant he hadn't been at the OK Corral to help the Earps and Doc Holliday. From what he'd heard, even though that shootout had happened some time ago, Wyatt and Doc were still hunting some of those cowboys down. Apparently, Wyatt was intent on his revenge for the crippling of one of his brothers, Virgil, and the murder of the other, Morgan. Trinidad was fairly quiet, especially since Bat had taken over as sheriff. And even in a position of authority, it seemed to be a place where Bat could relax, lay back, and take stock. So far, he hadn't decided much, and all that was ahead of him today was what to have for breakfast and where. He stepped down from the boardwalk, crossed the street, and began walking toward a nearby restaurant, exchanging greetings with some of the townspeople, all of whom were very grateful that Bat Masterson was the Marshal of Trinidad. Butler was close enough to Trinidad to have ridden in the night before, but he decided to camp first and then ride in come morning. He wasn't sure how Bat Masterson was going to greet him,
Masterson didn't know that it was Butler who had sent him the telegram, telling him that his brother Jim was in danger in Dodge. It was that telegram that drew Bat away from Tombstone before all hell broke loose there. Jim Masterson actually was in danger in Dodge, and Bat's arrival in Dodge did set off the shootout, which Butler was part of, that resulted in all the parties, the surviving parties, leaving town. Bat had not been happy with what had happened, and Butler decided never to tell him that he'd sent the telegram. But even not knowing that, Bat might not be glad to see him in Trinidad. Still, he intended to ride in and test the waters. He'd been out of Leadville for a few days now, and was looking for a place to stop for a while, maybe just a few days, before continuing west. He'd been on his way to California when he'd heard about Leadville, and his detour there had been profitable. But he was now ready to head west again. All he had to do was outfit himself in Trinidad, and he'd be on his way. He woke that morning and decided to have breakfast in town. So he broke camp without so much as a pot of coffee, mounted up, and headed for town. He had his fingers crossed that Bat Masterson would not run him out of town as soon as he saw him. Masterson had decided on a place for breakfast, a restaurant a couple of blocks from his office. He was about to go inside when he heard a horse coming down the street. It wasn't an unusual sound, but for some reason this morning, he stopped to have a look. The rider looked familiar from a distance. He was clad in a black gambler's suit, white shirt, and black felt-brimmed hat. Bat waited until he got closer, then stepped down into the street to intercept him.
"Never thought I'd see you again so soon," he said to Tyrone Butler.
"I was in Leadville," Butler said. "I just need a couple of days to rest up, and then I'm on my way to California."
"What's there?" "Poker, I hope." "We got poker here," I heard. "Step down, Butler," Bat said. "I was about to have breakfast inside here."
He indicated the restaurant they were in front of. "Any good?"
"Long as you don't want nothing fancy."
"Just a hot breakfast's all I want."
"Dismount then," Bat said. "We never did get to know each other in Dodge."
Butler, surprised by Masterson's reaction, said,
"Much obliged, Bat."
And did as he was invited to do. Chapter 6. Inside the restaurant, Bat sat with his back to the wall, leaving Butler to sit uncomfortably across from him.
"Don't worry," Bat said. "I'll watch your back. Least I can do after what you did for my brother."
"I didn't do much."
"Jim and I talked after the Dodge City thing was over," Bat said. "You and me, we didn't get a chance to talk. He told me you saved his life."
"Well."
A middle-aged woman came to the table then and said, "Morning, Marshall. What'll you have?"
"Steak and eggs, Maggie. What else?"
"Butler?"
"The same."
"Coffee?"
Maggie asked. Butler looked at Bat.
"The sheriff always has coffee," she said.
"Then I'll have some too."
"Thanks, Maggie."
Butler looked around.
"I know," Bat said. "It's empty. Word gets around where I'm having breakfast, and the place stays empty till I'm done."
"That the way you want it?"
"No,"
Bat said.
"But that's the way it is. When you got a rep with a gun, folks don't want to be around you much. And if you're wearing a badge, that goes double."
"Folks like Maggie don't mind?"
"Nobody minds. They like having me here as sheriff. Eating breakfast somewhere else is a small price to pay."
"What made you come here after Dodge?" didn't come straight here, but ended up here, Bat said. They needed a marshal. I needed a place to stay for a while. I also got a faro layout in one of the saloons, so I'm doing pretty well. Where'd you go after Dodge?
Here and there. Ended up in Leadville for a little while.
I heard a gambler killed 3 men in Leadville some time ago, Bat said.
That you?
That was me.
3-on-1? I had an advantage.
What was that?
They were all stupid.
Guess you and me'd have that advantage over most folks I've met, Bat said.
Maggie came over with the coffee and promised the plate soon.
She'll get him out here quick, so I'll eat and skedaddle, Bat said.
I'll eat quick, Butler offered. I've got to get my horse seen to and get myself a room.
I've got some rooms over in my saloon, Bat said. You can have one if you want.
On what condition? Butler asked, wondering if Bat had a table or actually owned a piece of the place.
Bat smiled. Hey, you are smart. I need a relief dealer. You do that for me, and you can have the room free.
Can't make myself much money if I'm dealing for the house.
I'll pay you. I can make more playing poker for myself.
So play poker for yourself, Bat said.
Don't play nowhere else in town, and you can still have the room. But you can also relieve me when I need it. You can deal faro, can't you?
Sure, but let me get this straight. You want me to play exclusively in your place and relieve you once in a while at your faro table? Butler asked. That's all you want?
That's it. Sounds cushy to me. We got a deal?
For how long? Butler asked.
Long as you want, Bat said. I get the feeling you and me ain't long for this town anyway.
Bat stuck his hand out, and Butler shook it.
You got a deal.
And we got breakfast, Bat said, sitting back as Maggie laid down the large plates of steaming food.
Eat up.
They caught up a bit more during breakfast, but in the back of his head, Butler was wondering why Bat was being so friendly to him. True, he had saved Jim Masterson's life, and he stood beside both Masterson brothers in a firefight. But he and Bat didn't exchange 2 words afterward. And then everybody, Bat, Jim, Neil Brown, and Butler, got into the wind and were gone. But Bat's offer was too good to pass up. And he was right about the breakfast. It had been real good. Both men finished about the same time and left the restaurant.
There's a livery right down the street, Bat said. After you get your horse taken care of, come back out to the main street and make a left. My place is 2 blocks down on the right.
What's it called?
The Bonanza, Bat said.
You gonna be there when I get there? Butler asked.
I've got to make some rounds, but I'll end up there.
Don't worry. You'll have a room waiting. Got some pretty gals working there, too. You can have your pick.
That come with a job?
Bat laughed and said, That's gonna be up to them.
Chapter 7. The Bonanza was impressive. It looked to be fashioned after saloons Butler had seen in places like Wichita, Ellsworth, and Dodge City. He stepped through the batwing doors, carrying his saddlebags and rifle, and stopped just inside. It was all glass and wood paneling. The bar, if not the longest in the West, very close, looked like cherry wood. The paintings on the wall were all of voluptuous women in the nude. Butler recognized the artist as Peter Paul Rubens and wondered if any of them were originals.
It was early, and the place was empty, obviously not yet open for business. There were two bartenders preparing the bar for when they did open. All of the gaming tables were covered. Standing at the bar was Bat Masterson, drinking a cup of coffee.
"Come on in, Butler," Bat called. "What do you think of the place?"
"It's amazing," Butler said, joining Bat at the bar.
"Drink? Coffee?"
"Coffee'd be good." It was a drink Butler could never have enough of. Bat waved at one of the bartenders, who gave him a refill and Butler a fresh cup.
"This is Roscoe, our head bartender," Bat said. "That's Willie."
Roscoe, a ruddy-faced man in his 30s, nodded. Willie, 10 years younger and fresh-faced, waved.
"Willie's in training," Bat added.
"Where's your table?" Butler asked.
"In the corner back there."
Bat used his chin to point.
"When do you take the cover off?"
"I've got one deputy," Bat said.
"When he comes on duty, I open the table up. With you here, though, I can open up earlier and stay open later."
"I've got to admit, it's been a while since I dealt faro," Butler said.
"You never forget,"
Bat said, nodding.
"The one thing Neil Brown told me about you in Dodge was that you were a good card player."
"Poker player," Bat waved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.